programs which, for example, support mathematical instructions right on the CPU. This implementation in the C library is not used, but replaced by the compiler directory with the corresponding machine instructions. In Java, it's mostly mathematical functions or things like system array copy. But Intrinsix can also expose functionality which is not expressible in the language itself. For example, transactional memory, there is no means of using transactional memory in, from C++, but GCC has these functions which you can see here, xbegin, xend, which mark a transaction and this translate to the corresponding machine instructions. So you can now use at least some kind of transactional memory functionality of the new Intel CPUs from within C. The same holds true for Java, for example, unsafe allocate instance, which allocates a Java object without calling the instructor, without calling the constructor. It's actually not allowed by the language, but for some things it's needed, like deserialization. So there are functions in the unsafe API which are implemented as intrinsics because you cannot implement them in Java. Also in Java 9, you will have a new method on thread, which is called onSpinWait, which on Intel CPUs translate to the pause instructions, so you can do more effective spin loops, for example. It's JEP 285. Also, Intrinsix offer direct access to CPU instructions, because most, because often CPU vendors come up with new instructions in every new CPU generations, and compiler optimizations are often not that fast, so compiler vendors give people access to these new instructions through Intrinsix, which map directly to CPU instructions. For example, in Java, you have unsafe load fans on weak memory architectures like PowerPC. It's sometimes necessary to place fences, which is not possible within Java, but by using these functions, it's possible. So let's start with a very simple example. I've prepared a Hello World program, and we have this say hello function here, and we will replace this say hello function with an intrinsic. So usually if you call system out print line, prints output stream will be created, a print stream, and it will somehow delegate to the native C implementation, and then we will finally print the output. And we do a very simple time measurement. So let's see. When you run this program, you see it's about 7 million nanoseconds, and when we now use the intrinsics, which is enabled by the XX plus JEconf switch, you see it's obviously much faster. But intrinsics, because I mean, the whole Java call chain is just substituted by direct output. But intrinsics also come with a little drawback. So the system, the compiler or the runtime system must exactly know what your function is doing and able to replace it. So for example, when we change our Java program and prepare it for the next conference, like say Joker, which will be in autumn in St. Petersburg, and we recompile the program, and now we run it. It will print Privet Joker, but if you run with the intrinsic, you will probably guess that the output is still JEconf, because we changed the semantics, but the intrinsic is still the same. So that's actually the reason why you cannot simply do intrinsics for user code. So the hotspot only lets you do, hotspot only allows intrinsics for standard API functions. So how I've done this example, I will show you later on. There is some tricks how you can do it, but you have to recompile the hotspot in order to enable that. Okay, what other problems do you face with intrinsics? So there is observability, for example. Maybe you know that there is in Java the possibility to use bytecode instrumentation with the JavaLang instrument package and Java agents written in the Java language. This functionality is often used by monitoring agents, coverage tools, or event loggers, which at class loading take your bytecode and insert new calls to some logging function or something else in order to track your program. So if you write a simple Java instrumentation agent, I've done this here, I will not go through the program, but it's not too long. If you look at the slides after the talk, you will see that it's possible, very, very easy. And I've written an instrumentation agent which actually prints method enter and method exit of every method. So let's see how the output looks like. So first we run without our hello intrinsic, and we load the instrumentation agent, which is in the jar file, and we instrument all the classes in the org Simonis package. And you will get the obvious output. First we enter the main method, then we enter the say hello, then we have the output. Privet, it's still the old program now, which I've changed. And then we exit all these functions. So now when we run with the intrinsic, you will see that the instrumentation has no effect. Actually, the code has been instrumented, but we do not enter the Java code at all, because the call to say hello was replaced in the hotspot interpreter with a direct native call to the print function. We have a similar problem with JVMTI agents. JVMTI, it's another API which allows tool vendors to directly access the hotspot, the virtual machine internals from C or C++. You can use the JVMTI a protocol, for example, for debuggers or profilers. So GDB or the Eclipse debugger uses JVMTI to stop the threads, to put breakpoints into the virtual machine, and so on. And JVMTI agents, they access the hotspot through JVMTI and JNI native functions. So again, I've written a simple JVMTI tracing agent, which you can have a look at if you're interested. And again, it registers callbacks for method entry and method exit events. And you will see that we will see the same thing when we run our instrumentation agent, which has now instrumented all classes in the org Simonis package. Then you will get events for the corresponding method entries and method exits. And if we do the same with the intrinsic, you will see that we get no JVMTI events for entering the say hello method because it was replaced. So let's look at the effect that this has. For example, when you do Java debugging, we start our program now with debugging switched on. Sorry. Let's say without using the intrinsic. No, sorry, this was the wrong one. So this is the one I wanted to look. So we start the program without intrinsic, and we say we want to do debugging on the local port 8000, and we stop in suspended mode. And now when we attach from from JDB. We will place a breakpoint. We say stop in org Simonis hello world, say hello. And then we say run. And we stop at the breakpoint. We can look where we are, and everything is fine. So again, when we start the program with the intrinsic, we will not be able to stop in this method. Stop in org Simonis. Hello. Say hello. You see the breakpoint has been set by the debugger, by the JVMTI agent, but the application didn't stop. So when you are debugging a Java program and you set a breakpoint, for example, in Mars SQRT method, and you want to see how square root is implemented in Java, and you're running on x86, you won't enter the method. If you're running, for example, on Itanium, you most probably will enter the method because Itanium, for example, has no instructions for a square root, so they will use the Java implementation in the Java library. And intrinsics are not only available in Hotspot, also at J9 or Azul or other VMs support intrinsics, but every VM supports other intrinsics, and it is also dependent on the platform on which the VM is running. Okay, let's look at some behavioral changes. I've prepared another small program, which I want to explain to you. So we have a simple main program, which takes three arguments, a seed value, a warm-up value, and a count value. First, we call the compute function 20,000 times with the warm-up value. Warm-up will be 1. And our compute function does count. It loops count times, so this is first one time, it will loop one time during the warm-up and compute some mathematical function and return it. And after we've done the warm-up, we do this, enable to compile the compute method with the C2 server compiler. And once it's compiled, we will call the compute function with a huge count, usually like a billion or so, so that this function will need a lot of time. So let's see how that behaves. Okay, we use two new extended options. The one is print compilation, which will tell us which methods are just in time compiled by the hotspot. And we also use the option print inlining, which tells us which methods are inlined during JIT compilation. This is the seed value, this is the loop count for the warm-up, and this is the loop count for the last call to compute. And we put a time before at the beginning to measure the whole execution time. So what you can see now is that our compute method gets compiled by the just-in-time compiler, and the calls to sinus, square root, and pow are actually not inlined, but intrinsified. So print inlining tells you if a method has been inlined or just in time compiled, or if it has been replaced by the virtual machine through special code. So we can now disable the usage of intrinsics by saying using the extended option minus inline mass natives. This will tell the virtual machine not to use intrinsics, and you will see you get huge output now. So what does this mean? You can see now that we get here, we compile our method several times. This is because I will explain you later why, but it takes a lot more time because obviously the mathematical functions have not been replaced by intrinsics, But instead, you see, you have here the real calls to Java lang mass sinus, and Java mass lang sinus again calls Java lang strict mass sinus. And this one is a native method, which actually uses the FDLib implementation of mathematical function. This is a C library implementation of mathematical functions. So a lot more code gets executed now. It takes a lot longer time. So usually would say, why not always use intrinsics? So I will show you one more funny thing. When we run in interpreted mode, which means we do not JIT compile anything, you will see that the program will actually run faster, like with JIT compilation, because, for example, in the interpreter, it's not possible to disable the mass natives. They are always used. In compiled method, we can enable them, and then it takes a lot more time. So why is it possible? What other problems are we facing with this? Before I will show you how this this looks in the generated code. So I'll just clear the screen so you get better view. So it's here. So when we are using our mass intrinsics and we are using the compile command print, this instructs the just-in-time compiler to print the assembly code which it generates for the compiled methods. And if you run this, we see a lot of output, but it actually just means that our method has been compiled. And when you look here at the generated code, so this is actually machine code that has been generated. And you see you have just a single assembler instructions for square root. It uses the XMM register and actually calls the call to maslang. Sinus was replaced by a single instruction, so of course this gives you the best performance. If we do the same but disable the inlining of mass natives, we get a huge output again. But the one thing we will see is that we have now here real calls to Java calls to Java lang strict mass square root, and we also have here a thing called save point. So always at calls, Java remembers the state of all the local variables, and always when Java when the virtual machine returns from a call. It has the possibility to stop the virtual machine for a save point to do, for example, garbage collection or things like that. So what happens, what can be the problem with our mass natives? Let's finally come to my point. So I've just changed the previous program by it's the same compute function like before. We warm it up and we use it here. The only difference is I start a new thread after the warm-up, a daemon thread, and this thread will sleep for 1 second and then call systemgc. So when we run this program now, what we will see is we run without inlining the natives, and we use verbose gc to see the gc output, and as you can see, the output is as expected. Every second, there will be a system GC. So if you now use intrinsics, the output is a little different. You see, the program finishes faster. This should actually finish now. It just took 7 seconds. The one before, I just stopped it after 8 seconds. It would take around 30 seconds. But we had no GC here. And the problem why we had no GC is because, as we saw in the assembler output, all the calls, all the Java calls had been replaced by simple instructions. So we have now a tight loop which is running without any calls inside. So the VM has no chance to stop for a GC. And if we have such loops with intrinsics, this optimization can lead to bad performance with regard to save point behavior. That's TTS, time to save point. So you always have to think about such effects when you are using intrinsics. So usually intrinsics should be done only for very small parts of the VM which run very fast, because while you're inside an intrinsic, the VM has no possibility to get control until you return from the intrinsic. This is different to Java native calls. We will come to the difference of Java native calls and intrinsics in a moment. Okay, so what intrinsics do we have in Hotspot, and how are they implemented? So if you look at the source code, there is a file called VM symbols HPP, and there all the intrinsics which are available in the Hotspot are declared. So we have two slightly different kind of intrinsics. One is called library intrinsics, one is called bytecode intrinsics. Library intrinsics is what I showed you until now. They just replace API function by some special code. Bytecode intrinsics actually work a little different, and I won't speak too much about them. They actually prevent some functions from being inlined, and in the later optimization stage, there are some special optimizations which detect calls in during JIT compilation. The virtual machine builds up a graph called intermediate representation, and it does some optimizations on this graph. And for example, a lot of string buffer functions, they are not inlined, and during one optimization stage, the virtual machine can detect such calls if they are not inlined, and collapse them with other calls and do some optimizations on them. As I told you, intrinsics are only available for system classes, and since Java 9, which we'll have soon, there is a new Java JDK internal annotation called Hotspot Intrinsic Candidate, and all intrinsics within the Java API have to be annotated with this annotation. And actually, the Hotspot, when it starts up, it checks that all functions annotated with Hotspot Intrinsic Candidate have a corresponding intrinsics implementation in the Hotspot, and vice versa. If there is a intrinsic implementation in Hotspot and the corresponding API function is not annotated, that will give you an error. And this is controlled by the check intrinsics option. This has been done because in the past, a lot of time, people implemented some intrinsics in the Hotspot, then somebody changed the Java in the Java API, some implementation, and then the intrinsics didn't work anymore, and nobody realized it was performance regression, but that's not obvious. So now there is a tight check between methods which should be inlined from an API perspective and intrinsics implementation in the Hotspot, and they should always match. So some more words about library intrinsics. Again, the library intrinsics can be implemented in three different places. First, the Hotspot runs in interpreted mode. And as we've seen before, our Hello World intrinsic, I've implemented that one only in the interpreter. But in general, the interpreter has very few intrinsics, just for the mass intrinsics that you've saw, CRC32, and that's basically it, because the general perception is that code will only run for very few time in the interpreter, and then it will be just in time compiled anyway. So most of the intrinsics are implemented in the C1 client compiler, or actually most of them in the server compiler, because that's actually the code which should run in a productive system. You should have like 90% or more than 90% of your code should be compiled at C2 level, and that's where you want to have the best performance. Okay, if you want to look at the source code, you can use these slides to navigate to the source code and come to the corresponding places where C2 compiler, for example, decides it supports an intrinsic. There's a function called is intrinsic supported, and there's a big case statement which lists all the supported intrinsics. So how do we control intrinsics? We've seen before the print compilation and print inlining options, which are very useful if you want to check that your code is really compiled, inlined, or intrinsified as desired. You have to check intrinsics option, which gives you this warning here, which I've explained to you before, if the implementation in Java and in Hotspot do not match. And then you have the possibility to disable and enable various intrinsics. So the most convenient one for disabling intrinsic is using the disable intrinsic command line option, and there and you give this the argument for this option is actually the ID defined in the VM symbols file, which I've showed you before. So you actually have to look that up in the source code, but then you can easily disable or enable single intrinsics for testing, for example. All the slides are on GitHub, so it's enough if you take a picture from the last slide and you can look at it at any time. Then we have various groups of intrinsics like AAS, CRC32, MassExact. We have class thread intrinsics, inline, unsafe operations, and so on, and a huge bunch of options. You already see from these options that intrinsics have a very long history in Hotspot, and that's why everybody who started to implement some intrinsics added new options. That's why we have this unfortunate situation. Actually, at the beginning of Hotspot, people reserved like one byte for the intrinsic ID of an intrinsic function, which was enough for 255 intrinsics, and this was enough for mostly 10 years. But in the last time, people started to implement more and more intrinsics, and there was no more place in one byte, so now they've extended it to 16 bits, so now we have enough IDs for 64,000 intrinsics, which will be hopefully enough. For example, all the if you heard the talk of Alexei Shipilyov, who's done the compressed string stuff, which will come in Java 9, they use a lot of intrinsics for comparing compressed and not compressed strings, for implementing all the string functions in an efficient way for compressed and uncompressed string. This is all done by intrinsics. Same holds true for a lot of cryptographic functions like AES or GHASH and things like that, which become more and more important and which are now supported by most modern CPUs like PowerPC or Intel. They have special instructions, so people start to intrinsify this functionality. But it's not always easy, because as I told you before, you have to match the exact semantics. So Java, if Java defines that it has 64-bit floating point or double arithmetic, you cannot easily use the 80-bit floating point registers of Intel, for example, because it has slightly different rounding mode. And in the past, there were a lot of problems. For example, if some mass function was intrinsified in the interpreter but not in the JIT compiler, then your method was executed a few times in the interpreter, give you some result, and then just while switching to the compiled code, the result changed, which is bad. But I think most of these problems have now been resolved in Hotspot. So what's the difference between native method and intrinsic method? Actually, you could get all the functionality of intrinsic method by implementing them as native method. That's true. but you could not get the performance because, as we saw before, when you do a native method call, the VM holds a so-called JVM state, because while you're in native code, the VM can stop a thread and do garbage collection or other things it has to do, because it knows that while you're in native code, it knows exactly which registers hold pointers into the Java heap. And this was the assembly code I showed you before, when after the JVM call, we had all these locals and the type of references they hold. So also, for native calls, you sometimes have to switch between the Java and the native calling conventions. You have to do argument marshalling and things like that. And that's why native calls are relatively expensive, especially a lot more expensive than just intrinsifying functionality. But for things like I/O, for example, which is slow anyway, native calls are quite okay. So a lot of native functionality, like all the I/O stuff or graphic stuff or things like that, is implemented with native function and not intrinsics. And obviously, you, while doing I/O, you want to be able to do GC, because I/O can take infinite. And if you would do I/O like I did in my introductory example with say hello, and printing, for example, to a NFS share, and this would take like minutes, the VM didn't want to wait so long. So this is better done in a native call. So how did I implement? I come now to the explanation of how I did implement my Hello World example. As I told you, VM symbols, HPP is the file where all intrinsics are declared in a big preprocessor define, which is not very nice from a debugging point of view, but adding intrinsics is not that hard. So actually, the do intrinsic call here does actually define the intrinsic, and the intrinsic ID is say hello, and it will intrinsify the say hello name function, which is say hello, with the say hello signature, which is void, and that's actually it. And in the interpreter, we have to define the new method kind, because the interpreter has different kind of methods which it can call, like native methods or intrinsified methods, and hello world will be one special method kind now in our interpreter. And then when we use the jeconf switch to enable the method, and we check the intrinsic ID of a method every time before the interpreter calls the method, it calls the method kind function to see what kind of method it has to call, and we then return the new defined method type. And we of course also have to create a method entry for this kind of method type, for our hello world say hello method kind. And this is actually the template interpreter generates code at startup. For example, for calling native method, it generates so-called adapters, which are generated machine code, which do method argument marshalling and so on. And we will now generate a special entry for the say hello method, and this is actually the final code. It's just assembly. We move standard out and message, which is privet jconf, to registers. We do call the fputs function from the C library and pop the arguments, and that's it. So actually, when the interpreter sees a call to say hello, and we switch the intrinsic on for it, it will actually execute this few machine instructions here. That's why it was obviously faster. And a last point, I told you that the hotspot only allows intrinsics for Java API functions, and this is this method which I had to change here. So usually this is the check I added. If it's not here, usually we would return here, because if our class is not loaded from the system class loader, we will just return no, that there is no intrinsic available. So as I told you, you have to change the VM in order to make that happen. So how do we implement now real useful intrinsic? For example, for Java util random next in. So this is in the standard library, so it's perfectly valid to implement this function as an intrinsic. And maybe you know that new Intel CPUs have a random number generator which can be used. So we annotate the next in function with hotspot intrinsic candidate. In VM symbols, we just declare our new next in intrinsics, which is in the class Java util random, and it's in the next in function. Same like for the interpreter stuff. Now we have to pay attention, because we can only use these intrinsics if you're running on a new CPU, right? So this is when the hotspots start up, it usually does a detection of the features the CPU offers. So we have to add a new check for the CPU RDRUND instruction. If it's available, we do that. And we have to implement a generator for this function. So the hotspot has a built-in macroassembler, which is used by the JIT compiler to generate assembler. It works like macroassembler, which you know, which you can write a program in, like in Visual Studio or GCC, JASM. But this is inside of the virtual machine, because the JIT has to create assembler code at runtime. So we add the RDRUND long instruction to this assembler, which actually generates a RDRUND instruction in a machine code. And now we come to the internals of the C2 compiler. C2 compiler generates an intermediate representation, a graph representation of your code, and it inlines a lot of stuff and does a lot of optimizations on these nodes. And in a final stage, these abstract nodes will be matched against so-called machine nodes, which are declared in a special architecture description file which is special for every architecture. So the intermediate representation is the same on all architectures. So for example, loop optimization and things like that are the same on all platforms. But then when you finally match to the machine representation, you have platform-dependent stuff. And here we declare a new general node, rand e node, which will represent our next int, our call to next int. And on the machine side, we create a new node which matches actually this abstract node and replaces it through a call to the corresponding and generates the corresponding machine code for it. Then in the library call kit, that's the place where inlining happens, we check that we have an intrinsic for the next in function, and instead of inlining the bytecodes, and like we would do it with a normal function, we actually just generate the abstract rand e node which we've created before. And this abstract node will then be matched against the machine node and will result in just a single machine instructions. So we have very few time left. I will just show you how that works. So we run the random example, which is just calling next int a few times, and you see it's 1.6 seconds. And when we disable the intrinsics, which we do now with the disable intrinsic functions, you see it's actually two times slower. So this is not so much an improvement, you may guess, but the fact is that you now get real random numbers from the CPU, and you can get a lot of them. Because usually when you use random, on Linux, for example, you use device urandom, and this can block. And if you're running on servers, for example, they have very less random numbers in their generator, and this is sometimes a huge problem. So using the random instruction of the CPU is not only, I mean, implementing this intrinsic is not only for improving the call to the random function, but to get real randomness from the CPU. I mean, as long as you trust Intel and the vendor. So let's have a very quick look. Let's have a very quick look how this worked. So this is actually we have here our orgsimon is random foo method, and it calls next int, and you see it's intrinsified. That's all. And in machine code, you see that this actually executes just the rdrand instruction, which is very good, very fast. If we disable the intrinsic, again with disable intrinsic next int, you will now see that Java util random next int will be now inline, but not intrinsified. So next int has an implementation which again calls secure random next, and secure random next calls secure random next bytes, and then it calls the service implementation of secure random and so on. And that's a lot more code, and that's actually why it's slower. So I think I run out of time, so I will stop my talk at this point. The slides are on GitHub with the examples. You can watch them there and download the examples if you want. If you have any question, you can email me at any time or just ask them now.
One last. Any question? No?
For preparing these examples, I used Java 9, like a development version of Java 9, but most of the intrinsics are the same in Java 8 as well, so there's no difference between regarding to intrinsics between Java 8 or 9 or even 7. It's just you just have more intrinsics in 8 and again more in 9, but the mechanism is the same.
Hi, my name is Vitaly. Thank you for your presentation. I actually have a question. Do we have some projects or frameworks with, I don't know, some patched JVM version which would simplify writing an assembler code itself, not to recompile JVM itself?
No, I don't have that, and it's actually not not intended by the VM writer. So it's because of all these problems I showed you, it's actually it's made intentionally, it's made very hard and only available for API code, because if you start to inject your own assembler code into the VM, I mean, you have no guarantees. I mean, it's already the same with JNI. If you're starting to write your own JNI code, if you've done that, you probably know that it's very easy to crash the VM, because I mean, then the VM can take no responsibility. From native code, you can access everything, change everything, and with assembler, it's even harder. So it's actually something for VM writers.
Thank you.
One more question, maybe. I think we have until the next speaker comes. No? Okay.
So you can create your own only in Java 9 or in Java 8 also.
No. I mean, actually, you can only create your own intrinsics if you recompile the virtual machine, and you can do that with any version. But then you have to do your own build and your own binaries of the virtual machine. And it will be not portable, so I mean, you have to compile the hotspot yourself. You can take OpenJDK, like I've did for my example, then implement an intrinsic for, say, Hello or for Hello World. But this intrinsic will only work with my VM, which I built. So if I give my Say Hello World program to somebody else, this intrinsic won't work. So,
and there is no way to identify that source code has changed, right? So like your change say hello
yes,
method.
Sure, yes, because this works on a APA level, yes, by name, yes. Mm-hmm. So yes, and that's actually the reason why you shouldn't do it for your own code, because somebody may change your code and it does not, the virtual machine has no idea how your code changes.
It will work the old way, right?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.